Hello good people, Eber here with Hardware Canucks, and guess what? It's second generation Ryzen performance review day. Yeah, I'm not sure if that sounded right, but regardless, I'll be walking you through my experience testing out the new Ryzen 7 2700X CPU, and of course, I'll be sharing my performance results compared to my 1700X that's sitting right behind me in my workstation PC, because, you know, and perhaps come to a conclusion as to whether or not if it's actually worth upgrading, because the specs on the 2700X are pretty good. I mean, it's not significantly better than its predecessor, but it's still worth finding out, especially if you're an existing Ryzen system owner and if you're, you know, rocking one of these, or not this, but the 1700X CPU. I'll also be talking about my overclocking experience with this new processor, and of course talk about the new architecture and the new platform, which is X470. So let's dive in right after this.
Are you ready?
Okay.
Watch this.
Whew. So that is what the components must feel like inside the H500P mesh by Cooler Master. Check it out in the description below. Whew.
All right, so before we move on to the performance results, I wanted to briefly talk about the new Zen Plus architecture and what AMD has done to improve the performance of these new second generation Ryzen CPUs. First and foremost, these processors are based off a new 12 nanometer process, but they've only done a few optimizations to improve latencies. So don't confuse Zen Plus with Zen 2. That's not the case here. What they've done here is increased the IPC by roughly 3%, improved L3 cache latency by 16%, and better memory latency by 11%. So these new Ryzen CPUs won't have a problem supporting faster memory speeds. Zen Plus also brings a few more improvements, like top clock speeds have been lifted by 250 MHz. So theoretically, you won't have a problem achieving 4.35 GHz on your best core, and all core overclocks round out to about 4.2 GHz, and we'll get to the results later on. AMD has also managed to lower power consumption by 11% when compared to last generation processors at the same clock speed. This could potentially give us more thermal headroom for overclocking as well, which is nice. They've also made some enhancements with Precision Boost 2 and XFR 2, or in other words, Extended Frequency Range 2. Let's start with Precision Boost. So expect substantial clock speed increases in multi-threaded workloads. Again, with the new 12 nanometer Zen Plus technology, these processors can achieve higher frequencies with the same power consumption compared to first gen Ryzen. So essentially expect turbo clocks reaching as far as 4.3 GHz at stock settings. XFR 2 has now been applied to all cores on these new CPUs, so now the algorithms can automatically detect if there's thermal headroom and it'll apply the frequency boost automatically on all cores, provided you have adequate cooling in the first place. Let's take the 2700X for instance. AMD has included this Wraith Prism cooler that features an RGB ring, an RGB fan, and an RGB logo. Complete RGB over here. Plus, it features direct contact heat pipes, and overall, it looks like a beefier out-of-the-box cooling solution when compared to Intel's offerings. Speaking of Intel, if you decide to pick up an 8700K right now, you won't find a cooler included, which is something to note, especially since you're paying $50 more than the 2700X, yet you're only getting 6 cores and 12 threads. I do plan on putting the 2700X to the 8700K to see how well they do head-to-head, so stay tuned for our full performance analysis video later on. Yeah, that just had to happen. Anyways, so there's the new Wraith Prism cooler that comes out of the box with the new Ryzen 7 2700X CPU. It's directly from AMD and it comes with two LED zones. So you have this ring that goes around the fan and of course the LED fan by itself. And you can control this either through MSI's Mystic Light software, which is, you know, this motherboard, or you can use Asus Aura. The only thing is that you can't control these zones through those protocols. You'll have to obviously use AMD's dedicated software, which interestingly enough is a partnership with Cooler Master. So that's pretty interesting. And as you can see, it gives full control of the cooler. You can adjust the lighting through this software. I'll leave a link to the download page for this software in the description down below, just in case. And by the way, I had to contact an AMD PR rep to figure out how to control the lighting zones for the Wraith Prism cooler, because out of the box, AMD doesn't give you any proper instructions. So all you get is obviously the box, the cooler, the cables, the CPU, and this manual sheet, or this instruction sheet. And it doesn't give you proper instructions as to where to find software link or where you're supposed to go and download it from. It is frustrating. I wish they included that in the instructions sheet, but at least now you know where you can go find it. So you're welcome. All right, so let's switch gears and discuss a little bit about X470. This isn't a major upgrade over the X370 platform, to be honest, because the only difference is an improved power infrastructure for achieving higher clock speeds with these new processors and the introduction of Store MI technology. It's basically a storage software that fuses two or more storage devices. So in this case, it could be your SSD and hard drive plus RAM into a single virtual disk. So the operating system reads it as a single drive. This is compatible with NVMe, SATA, and 3D XPoint drives, and it can be installed and reversed at any time, provided you have backed up your data beforehand. Store MI is an enhanced algorithm that learns your computing habits, and it moves frequently accessed blocks, in this case applications and files, between the array, giving users a speedy experience. I still have to play around with this program to give you guys my full verdict on this because AMD is still finalizing on the software, which should be available by the time this video goes live, so that would be a cool investigation video for another time. To quickly go over the test bench setup over here, I have the Ryzen 7 20700X sitting on an MSI Gaming M7 X470 motherboard. I'm also using 16GB of G-Skill's SniperX memory. It's a 16GB DDR4 kit. Its rated speed is 3400 MHz, which is kind of crazy. And interestingly enough, I was able to boot the 2700X at that speed, which is great. Unfortunately, the 1700X can only go as far as 3200 MHz. So for the stock-to-stock comparison, what I'll be doing is using the exact same memory kit at the same speed, so 3200 MHz on the 2700X and the 1700X. And to even make things even fairer, to avoid as much as variables as possible, I will be swapping out the 1700X CPU from my editing PC onto this motherboard so that we have pretty much identical hardware and do more of an apples to apples comparison. As for a cooling solution, I will be testing the 2700X initially with stock settings using the stock cooler that they provided. And of course, I'll be running all my benchmarks. For overclocking capabilities, if I'm not successful with the stock cooler, what I will be doing is I will be taking out the D15 cooler from my editing workstation PC, and I'll be installing it on this test bench over here to see how far I can push the overclock. And so now it's about time to overclock this CPU. So I'm gonna be using the stock cooler just to see how far I can push the overclock because, hey, they've included a cooler in the box, so it's good to see or good to know or good to find out how far can you actually push the clock speed on the 2700X. So I'll be using AMD's new Ryzen Master version 1.3 software, and they've done a few tweaks here. So first and foremost, they've given us this gold star per core. So this is basically your best core that you can work around with, especially if you're planning on just overclocking it. If you're planning on doing a single core overclock, this is something that will help you identify which one of your cores is the best. In this case, it's this one over here. And I've learned from AMD that during the production process, AMD preloads that map to the CPU, and therefore when you launch the Ryzen Master software, it'll show up right away which one of these cores are your first pick, and then moving on, you have your Silver Star over here, which is your second best core, and the rest, and this little silver dots over here. So yeah, I'm gonna be playing around with Ryzen Master software to see how far I can push this overclock. Should be pretty straightforward. I'm hoping I can achieve 4.2 to 4.3 gigahertz. We'll find out. So yeah, let's do this. Okay, so I've been spending about an hour trying to play around with the overclock with a stock cooler, and I was unfortunately not lucky enough to get a solid, stable result. I first tried 4.2 gigahertz at 1.425 volts, and luckily enough, Cinebench ran successfully. I got a score of 1881, I believe, which was impressive, but I did run the IDA 64 FPU stress test, and the system almost crashed halfway through, so that wasn't stable. I did try multiple configurations, 4.1, 4.125. I play around with the voltage, and this was all through Ryzen Master software. It's actually fairly straightforward, but I was unfortunately unlucky. And I did try playing around with the BIOS as well to see if I can maybe fiddle around with some settings, so the SoC voltage, and just see if the BIOS would help, but that didn't work out that great. So what I'm gonna do is swap the stock cooler for a beefier heatsink, like the Noctua D15S. I'm gonna run these tests again. I'm pretty sure I should be able to get a stable overclock because it's a beefier heatsink. It can pretty much handle anything you throw at it, which is great. So yeah, let's do that. So this is one of the downsides to a PGA socket. It's not as secure as what Intel offers. So, you know, when you decide to pull an air cooler off your motherboard, there's a very good chance that the CPU can just come with it. So just make sure if you don't find that CPU in there, it's definitely over here. It's definitely, All right, so I've successfully overclocked the 2700X to 4.2 gigahertz with a core voltage of 1.425 volts. And I'm running the Adobe Premiere test. This is the encoded test. I'm running a 4K 12-minute project. GH5 footage, by the way, so it's really stressing the CPU. As you can see, the core clock speeds are at 4.2 gigahertz. So after a successful 4.2 gigahertz overclock on the 2700X, I ran some synthetic real-world and some gaming tests on this processor, compared it to stock settings, and of course, throwing in the 1700X as well. So here are the numbers. Starting with Cinebench R15 running the CPU test, the 2700X at stock settings with the stock cooler, by the way, scored a little over 1800 points. That's 20% more performance compared to the 1700X at stock settings. The 4.2 GHz overclock on the 2700X with the memory speed bumped up to 3400 MHz gave us a score of 1886, so it's pretty darn impressive if you ask me. Switching to OpenGL, and we see that the lower clock speeds on the 1700X becoming a bottleneck. At stock settings, I got around a little over 100 frames per second compared to 118 frames per second on the 2700X at stock. This is all thanks to XFR2 being applied on all 8 cores along with the faster IPC. Overclocking the 2700X to 4.2 GHz gave us 124 frames per second. Blender running the BMW scene took 5 minutes and 10 seconds to complete on the 1700X compared to 4 minutes and 26 seconds on the 2700X. So that's roughly 16% faster. Overclocking the 2700X to 4.2 GHz shaves a little bit of time as well. Not by that much, but at least it's something. Same story goes for 3D Max Corona. The 2700X takes the lead here once again at stock settings, completing the render 18 seconds faster than the 1700X. The 4.2 GHz OC shaves a little bit of time, but once again, not too significant. Pavre really didn't show that much of an improvement with the 2700X, as the results compared to the OC setting and the 1700X at stock are barely noticeable. Moving on to some real-world tests, I took a 1-minute 4K timeline, exported it to YouTube 4K preset using Adobe Media Encoder, and as you can see, there isn't a significant difference between the 1700X and 2700X at its OC setting. We're talking maybe a 6-second difference between the three. But rendering a 12-minute project using the same 4K preset shows a little bit of improvement. The 1700X at stock completes that task by around 22 minutes compared to 19 minutes and 34 seconds on the 2700X. The 4.2 GHz overclock definitely shaved off a few minutes, which is pretty nice, but realistically speaking, it's all about the experience editing a video, and personally, I did notice a huge difference in that regard, which is a little disappointing. Okay, so moving on to some gaming benchmarks, and I hate to spoil it right now, but honestly, don't expect better frame rates with this new processor. Sure, you'll get slightly better 3D Max scores like what you see here with TimeSpy and Firestrike, but throughout my testing period, I didn't notice a significant increase in frame rates, at least through my naked eye. Take Battlefield 1 for instance, set to 1440p ultra settings. We see a 5% increase compared to the 1700X. I'd like to reiterate that memory speeds were set to 3200 MHz just to give an apples to apples comparison. Overwatch at 1440p set to Epic yielded roughly the same frame rates on both the 1700X and the 2700X, so nothing spectacular here. Doom at 1440p set to Ultra using the Vulkan API once again yields us the same results on both CPUs, and in this case, around 177 frames per second with a GTX 1080 Ti. Lastly, we have Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon at 1440p set to Very High. This setting taxes out on the GPU, but I noticed a 3% increase in frame rates compared to the 1700X. So those results really do speak for themselves, guys. And personally speaking, I didn't notice a huge difference between the 1700X and 2700X just in gaming performance by itself. But when you are thinking about synthetic workloads like, say, Cinebench or Blender, you could notice a slight improvement in rendering times when you decide to upgrade to the 2700X. But in all honesty, as I mentioned earlier, it's all about the experience. What's it like when you're actually working within that program? Are you experiencing any slowdowns? And I personally haven't noticed a significant difference. So that is a little bit disappointing. Now, would I recommend the CPU to anyone who is looking into building themselves? If you're looking to build a workstation PC, would I recommend the CPU? Absolutely. Because for $329, you're getting an 8-core CPU with 16 threads. This thing can overclock to 4.2 gigahertz, provided you have, you know, an AIO solution or an aftermarket, like something like the D15. It just worked right away, and the results are fantastic. You can get great rendering performance out of a 329 CPU, much better than what Intel's offering. But if you are an existing Ryzen system owner, say for example you own a 1700X, and if you're thinking about upgrading to Ryzen 2 or second generation Ryzen CPUs, I hate to say this, but I don't think you're going to notice a significant increase in performance. It's just not worth your money. So that about wraps up this brief comparison between the 1700X and the 2700X. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this new processor. What do you guys think about it? Are you impressed with the performance? Just not from a gaming perspective, but more from a synthetic workload perspective. Are you surprised by the Cinebench scores and the Adobe Premiere performance? Let me know in the comments down below. I'm Eber with HardwareConnects. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.